think right now what's really driving that fascination is that we are in a time of a whole lot of change, to the point that, you know, so many things have changed so fast in our culture with technology, with the way that we relate to people, you know, with jobs and economies and all that stuff, is that we don't have any stability. You know, back in the 50s, people knew that 10 years from now, their lives would be pretty much the same. I have no idea what life's going to be like in 3 years. I don't know what my job's going to be. You know, I don't know. Stuff, you know, Twitter and Facebook and stuff weren't even here 4 or 5 years ago. And so we just don't have any idea. And I think especially among really conservative religious people, there's a lot of fear in that. Part of it's a fear of the unknown. Part of it's a fear of technology, a resistance to change. And I think a lot of that drives some of the apocalypticism, because when you are presented with this fear, you naturally sort of have that fight or flight thing, and part of the flight is escaping it. And the desire to escape really plays into a bunch of the rapture scenarios, the hope for a second coming. And even if you take it outside of Christianity with a lot of the 2012 stuff, there's a lot of fear driving that, you know, that's these conspiracy theories, you know, that NASA's not telling us something about this rogue planet heading our way, or that, you know, all these ancient documents seem to be predicting some sort of doom. We have a culture of change, and that change has sort of transferred us into a culture of fear, and that's driving a lot of that.
I agree. And things are changing.
This guy named Edgar Wisenant wrote a book that said 88 Reasons the Rapture Will Be in 1988. He set the date, and yeah, I was a high schooler at the time. It really impacted me. But the way he got his message out is he sent his booklet to pastors all over the United States, sent it to them for free. And so these pastors preached to their congregations, and sort of it was this grassroots effort. If you didn't have a pastor who got the book, you didn't know about it. And now you've got, you know, all Harold Camping has to do is do his radio show, and everybody who believes him jumps on it, and then they can create websites, and they can start doing the billboards, and you see YouTube videos,
right?
And it just explodes. And so we can disseminate information so quickly now, right, that once anything gains traction, it's available to anybody, whether it's Harold Camping's rapture stuff, mm-hmm, or beliefs about, you know, the planet Nibiru, or the Mayan prophecies. Any of that stuff is readily accessible to whoever is looking for it. And right, so you don't have to wait for your pastor to come up with some weird scenario and tell it to you. It's right there for whomever.
Yeah, it's a fire hydrant of information and misinformation. So, yeah, it comes pouring out, I think.
We tend to be pretty short-sighted when we start thinking about the apocalypse. We always think it's like right around the corner, it's going to happen this year, or somebody predicts it. And so we get all, you know, fascinated by it. And we forget that this happens about every year and has happened every year for the history of humanity. I mean, at least since Jesus started talking about coming back. And you know, that's 2,000 years ago. And so we've had prophets and these doomsday theorists and different clergy members are always speculating that the end is near, and they're always wrong, yeah, always wrong. And so to me, it takes a lot of arrogance, I think, to come out with a prediction and say it is going to be this day and it's going to happen like this, because what you've got to do is you've got to convince yourself that all these other people, really smart people and well-meaning people and sometimes very holy people, they were all wrong, but me, I'm the one who's right about it. So you should listen to me this time.
Right.
And in all of human history, I'm going to be the one who got it right. Right. It takes a lot to be able to say that. And right, so to me, those are people that need to be knocked off their pedestals a little bit. Because as well-meaning as they are, you know, there are a lot of people who are gullible enough, or fearful enough, or hopeful enough to buy into it. And that's where the real problem is. It's not in some know-it-all who wants to convince people that he knows when Jesus is going to come back, or the apocalypse is going to occur, or this planet is going to strike the earth. It's the people who buy into it that really bother me, because there's stories all throughout history of people following their leader who says this is going to happen, and they stop planting crops, they sell their businesses, they leave their families, they abandon their homes. You know, they make all these very practical, life-changing decisions, and then it doesn't happen, and they're left with nothing.
Right.
They've lost all their possessions, they've lost their livelihood, they've lost their families, and a lot of cases they lose their faith because this is a guy they trusted,
right,
and he is very clearly wrong, or she is very clearly wrong. Pace because you know, if they're asking questions about the book, it's always the same kinds of questions. But yeah, getting to talk about it live is fun, so I appreciate it.
Well, thank you so much.